بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
In the name of Allah, the Most Gracious, the Most Merciful.
لا إله إلا الله. 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 لا إله إلا الله.
الحمد لله رب العالمين، وأصلي وأسلم على المبعوث رحمة للعالمين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه ومن اهتدى بهديه واقتدى بسنته إلى يوم الدين، وبعد. فقد قال جل وعلا في كتابه المجيد وفرقانه الحميد: أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. أم يحسدون الناس على ما آتاهم الله من فضله، فقد آتينا آل إبراهيم الحكمة وآتيناهم ملكا عظيما، فمنهم من آمن به ومنهم من صد عنه، وكفى بجهنم سعيرا. صدق الله العظيم. Honorable scholars, respected brothers, elders, mothers and sisters, as humans, as mortals, and more specifically as believers, we are constantly reminded of our ethical, our moral, and our religious duty to respond, assist, and aid the victims of tragedies and catastrophes. It's our duty, it's our responsibility. But unfortunately, we are very seldom reminded that the very bond of Iman that calls upon us and that governs and regulates and compels us to lend a helping hand to those that have been struck with a tragedy equally compels us to share in the happiness, the achievements, and the success of our fellow Muslims. And I must add by saying, it is easier to share in the pain of someone than to rejoice in the achievement of someone. In the Arabic language, they say, "Kafa bil mar'i hasida." Kafa bil mar'i hasida ay yaghtamma waqta sururik. The loudest definition of a man who harbors jealousy in his heart against you is he will be moaning and groaning with a big frown on his forelock the day something good happens in your life. So he won't have a smile, he won't say a kind word, it's too difficult for him to swallow a venture, a prosperity, a achievement in your life. And that brings me to the quotation of the great scholar and the great giant Al-Ghazali rahimahullah, when he said, "Al-hasadu mutashaqibun min al-bukhli." When you look at jealousy, it borders with the regular type of mizing, if not worse. Why? فَإِنَّ الْبَخِيلَ الَّذِي هُوَ يَبْخَلُ بِمَا فِي يَدِهِ عَلَى غَيْرِهِ. The common, the average, the known miser, and I don't say this in a trivializing context because it's a grave sin, is the person who mises with something in his possession. He clings on to it, he holds it tight, and he would not release it, and he would not pass it on to another person. وَالَّذِي يَبْخَلُ بِنِعَمِ اللَّهِ وَهِيَ فِي خِزَانَةِ قُدْرَتِهِ عَلَىٰ عِبَادِهِ فَشُحُّهُ أَعْظَمُ. And there's one person whose nature of mising is much greater. And what is that person? He mises with the bounties of Allah while they are in the treasures of Allah, and he tries his level best to prevent that from the servants of Allah. In English they say, you have two types of people. Some are generous by wealth and others are generous by spirit. So those that are generous by wealth are not always generous by spirit. Some people can spend thousands of dollars, but they cannot say a kind word to acknowledge someone else. A proud man is one who feels injured when others are praised. A proud man is one who feels violated. How can you acknowledge him in my presence? That's a violation to me. You're considering me less. And this is where our pitfall lies. وَالْحَسُودُ هُوَ الَّذِي يَشُقُّ عَلَيْهِ إِنْعَامُ اللَّهِ تَعَالَىٰ عَلَىٰ عَبْدٍ مِّنْ عِبَادِهِ بِعِلْمٍ أَوْ مَالٍ أَوْ مَحَبَّةٍ فِي قُلُوبِ النَّاسِ أَوْ حَظٍ مِّنَ الْحُظُوظِ حَتَّى أَنَّهُ لَيُحِبُّ زَوَالَهَا عَنْهُ وَإِنْ لَمْ تَحْصُلْ لَهُ فَهَذَا مُنْتَهَى الْخُبُثِ. A jealous man is one who wishes to curtail and prevent the bounties of Allah being conferred upon an individual, be it knowledge, be it fame, be it recognition, to the extent that even if I cannot have it, the next man must not own it. And this is the pinnacle of wickedness to which any human or believer can ever stoop, and may Allah save us. And hence the hadith of Abu Dawud, where the Master sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, Al-hasadu ya'kulu al-hasanat kama ta'kulu an-naru al-hatab. That jealousy will consume your virtues pretty much like how fire would eat up wood. والحسود هو المعذب الذي لا يرحم. Every victim of any tragedy gains the sympathy and the empathy of the world, but a jealous man, because he has shackled himself by his own actions. معذب الذي لا يرحم, for him there is no sympathetic eye. وَلَا يَزَالُ فِي عَذَابٍ دَائِمٍ. And this is key and this is profound. He said, a man who harbors jealousy, or a woman who harbors jealousy, lives in perpetual torment. Why? لِأَنَّ الدُّنْيَا لَا تَخْلُو قَطُّ عَنْ خَلْقٍ كَثِيرٍ مِّنْ أَقْرَانِهِ وَمَعَارِفِهِ مِمَّنْ أَنْعَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمْ بِعِلْمٍ أَوْ مَالٍ أَوْ جَاهٍ أَوْ مَحَبَّةٍ فِي قُلُوبِ النَّاسِ. Because the system of nature is that there always will be a more prolific author than you. There always will be a more dynamic speaker than me. There always will be a greater sister organization that will contribute more effectively than you. This is the system of Allah, that in every sphere of life, there will be people more prominent, more accepted, more favored than you. So to fight this system is actually combating against the system of nature. فَلَا تَخْلُوا عَنْ أَقْرَانِهِ وَمَعَارِفِهِ مِمَّنْ أَنْعَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمْ بِعِلْمٍ أَوْ مَالٍ أَوْ جَاهٍ. And then he goes on to say, فَلَا يَزَالُ فِي عَذَابٍ أَلِيمٍ. This jealous man will be in perpetual torment. وَلَعَذَابُ الْآخِرَةِ أَشَدُّ وَأَكْبَرُ. But only to know that the torment you suffer in this world is really the milder of the two of that which awaits you post-death. بَلَّا يَصِلُ الْعَبْدُ إِلَىٰ حَقِيقَةِ الْإِيمَانِ مَا لَمْ يُحِبَّ لِأَخِيهِ وَلِسَائِرِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ مَا يُحِبُّ لِنَفْسِهِ. In fact, you haven't tasted Iman until and unless you don't aspire that as I prosper, my sister organizations must equally prosper. As my venture sees fruition, so must the dream of my colleague see fruition. As my things materialize, so must the things of others materialize. بَلْ يَنْبَغِي أَن يُسَاهِمَ الْمُسْلِمِينَ فِي السَّرَّاءِ وَالضَّرَّاءِ. Until and unless we don't start sharing in the happy moments of others, we don't start rejoicing in their achievements, we are far from Iman. And then Imam Ghazali goes on to say, and he concludes this particular chapter by these words, فَإِنْ كُنْتَ لَا تُصَادِفُ هَذَا مِنْ قَلْبِكَ فَإِشْتِغَالُكَ بِطَلَبِ الْمَخْلَصِ عَنِ الْهَلَاكِ أَهَمْ مِنْ إِشْتِغَالِكَ بِنَوَادِرِ الْفُرُوعِ وَعِلْمِ الْخُصُومَاتِ. If you don't find this aspiration brimming in your heart, then it is integral and vital and of paramount importance that you occupy yourself in seeking deliverance from the state and don't engage yourself in understanding the intricate rulings of jurisprudence when your heart is full of pride and haughtiness and jealousy. The great scholar Ash-Shafi'i rahimahullah said, كُلُّ الْعَدَاوَةِ قَدْ تُرْجَى إِزَالَتُهَا إلا عداوة من عاتاك من حسدي. I can make any two rivals reconcile, and I can make peace between any form of antagonism that exists. But if the motivation of this hostility stems from jealousy, then let me admit my inability, I won't able to make peace between the two of them. If there are any two rivals and they are at loggerheads, leave them with me and I will make them embrace and shake hands. But if this stems from jealousy, then I have to admit my inability, my feebleness, my helplessness, because one is thriving to see the collapse of another. And he went on to say, وَذِي حَسَدٍ يَغْتَابُنِي حَيْثُ لَا يَرَى مَكَانِي وَيُثْنِي صَالِحًا حَيْثُ أَسْمَعُ. What a common malady in the ummah, that a nation that has been maimed and paralyzed and now becomes furtherly, more internally paralyzed by these types of slurs and comments. What does he say? وَذِي حَسَدٍ, the salient feature of a jealous man is, he will speak good of you in your presence. Oh, that's a great place. That's a wonderful school. Enroll your son there. He's an amazing leader. He's in the driving seat. They've got phenomenal talent. They have it delivering. They're awesome. They're brilliant. They're great. وَيَغْتَابُنِي حَيْثُ لَا يَرَى مَكَانِي. But as I sneak out, he says, this man's got an attitude. What they say in English, he who's wrapped up in himself makes a pretty small package. He who's wrapped up in himself makes a pretty small package. And someone said, my brother, stop patting yourself on your shoulder. You might just dislocate it. My brother, stop patting yourself on the shoulder. You might just dislocate it. وَذِي حَسَدٍ يَغْتَابُنِي حَيْثُ لَا يَرَى مَكَانِي. When he doesn't see me, يَغْتَابُنِي وَيُثْنِي صَالِحًا حَيْثُ أَسْمَعُ. And if he knows I'm listening, then he is raving about me. Then he is singing my praises. These are great people. These are amazing people. These are awesome people. But this is the great challenge that الشافعي puts to the world. He said, تَوَرَّعْتُ أَنْ أَغْتَابَهُ مِنْ وَرَائِهِ وَمَا هُوَ إِذْ يَغْتَابُنِي مُتَوَرِّعُ. I am going to rise beyond this mentality. And I am going to mature this hurdle of tit for tat attitude. This only makes my pace more sluggish and it only halts my vehicle from inching forward. I have vowed to Allah, as much as I know my rivals are speaking ill of me in my absence, I will never ever speak ill of them in their absence. What did Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu say on the occasion of Tabuk, when Amr ibn Wud scaled the trenches and Allah gave him the strength, and then Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu defeated his opponent, and then he made a very profound proclamation. He said, فَصَدَرْتُ حِينَ تَرَكْتُهُ مُتَجَدِّلًا كَالْجِذْعِ بَيْنَ دَكَادِكٍ وَرَوَابِي وَعَفَفْتُ عَنْ أَثْوَابِهِ وَلَوْ أَنَّنِي كُنْتُ الْمُقَتَّرْ بَزَّنِي أَثْوَابِي لَا تَحْسَبَنَّ اللَّهَ خَاذِلَ دِينِهِ وَنَبِيِّهِ يَا مَعْشَرَ الْأَحْزَابِ. He said, fate was in my favor. In Arabic they say, إِنَّ الْمَقَادِيرَ إِذَا تَسَاعَدَتْ أَلْحَقَتِ الْعَاجِزِ بِالْقَادِرِ. When fate becomes favorable, then the helpless become helpful. So Allah gave me strength, Allah gave me victory over my opponent, but I'm going to back off at this point that he has been defeated. But I know very well, if he had an upper hand over me, he wouldn't have rested after dropping me. He would have undressed me and he would have then mutilated my body. He would have dishonored me and he would have taken pleasure by dissecting my body into pieces. I know very well he would have gone for the jugular. He would have taken me to the cleaners. He would have taken me through every litigation. He would have really made mincemeat out of me. Today Allah has given me authority. I'm not going to do very much the same what he would have done to me. فَصَدَرْتُ, I backtracked. حين تركته when I dropped him متجدلا كالجذع بين دكادك والروابي وعففت عن أثوابي and I didn't lay my hands on his garment ولو أنني كنت المقتر but reverse the scenario hypothetically if he had the power بزني أثوابي my body would have been lying here in absolute nudity لا تحسبن الله خاذل دينه ونبيه Don't ever entertain the deception or the delusion that Allah will forsake his faith or abandon his Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Al-Shafi'i goes on to say, إِنِّي صَحِبْتُ النَّاسَ مَا لَهُمْ عَدَدٌ In the world I had the good privilege of interacting with tens, hundreds and thousands of people. وَكُنْتُ أَحْسِبُ أَنِّي قَدْ مَلَأْتُ يَدِي There were many people with whom I had a relatively good relation that I could swear on the authenticity of our relation. But then came the crunch time. Then came the test time. They say adversity makes some people break and it makes others break records. Adversity makes some people break down and it makes others break records. So here came the crunch time. لَمَّا بَلَوْتُ أَخِلَّائِ When I called upon my peers, I called upon my cronies, I called upon my acquaintances, وَجَدْتُهُمْ كَالدَّهْرِ فِي الْغَدَرِ لَمْ يُبْقُوا عَلَىٰ أَحَدِ I found them that each one of them in their own way had betrayed me. إِنْ غِبْتُ فَشَرُّ النَّاسِ يَشْتِمُنِي We'll be sitting in a gathering and all would be speaking nice and pleasant and good and great. And then I sneak out of the gathering. The evil of them amongst that gathering would start hurling the most nasty words the most condescending comments, the most derogatory remarks, the most inflammatory comments about me. وَخَيْرُ النَّاسِ لَمْ يَعُدِي While the best amongst them will never bother visiting me the day I'm sick. He said, I can live with that. That's life. Each man is gripped in his own life. Move on. I can make peace with that. But the thing with which I cannot reconcile, إِنْ رَأَوْنِي بِخَيْرٍ سَاءَهُمْ فَرْحِي وَإِنْ رَأَوْنِي بِشَرٍ سَرَّهُمْ نَكِدِيد I meet the man and I say, you're looking very happy and excited today. What's the occasion? He said, because I discovered that you're depressed and miserable. So my misery is their joy. My agony is their excitement. My fall is their ascension. My collapse is their achievement. وَإِنْ رَأَوْنِي بِشَرٍ سَرَّ وَإِنْ رَأَوْنِي بِخَيْرٍ سَاءَهُمْ فَرْحِيد And flip the coin, I meet the man and he's depressed and he's miserable and he's so, feels so dejected. What's the issue? I heard that you opened up a new shop. I heard that your event was successful. I heard that things are going great in your life. I heard that your daughter's got a great proposal. I believe that your son-in-law's got this or's got that. Subhanallah, where has this ummah lost it? Tabaqat ibn Sa'ad. Abu Dujana radiyallahu anhu is in his fatal illness. He's the veteran of Uhud. He was amongst those companions who had formed the human wall to shield the Master sallallahu alaihi wasallam against the intensity of arrows that were being showered at him. Somebody meets him in his fatal illness. His face is radiating light, brimming with effulgence and nur. So asked him, "Ma li wajhika yatahallal? What's all the joy and the excitement about?" Did he say, "I enjoy the privilege. These are my accolades. I'm a veteran of Uhud." I shielded the Master sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We fortified him. He said, "Ma min shay'in awthaqu 'indi min ithnatayn." I actually rely very much on two actions that I have invested with my Allah. Number one, kuntu la atakallam fi ma la ya'nini. I would never poke my nose in matters that didn't concern me. They say, what is the definition of gossip? Is a person who makes a mouthful out of an earful. He takes an earful and makes a mouthful out of it. I never involved myself in matters that didn't concern me. I never would indulge in this year. وَلَا تَقْفُ مَا لَيْسَ لَكَ بِهِ عِلْمٍ إِنَّ السَّمْعَ وَالْبَصَرَ وَالْفُؤَادَ كُلُّ أُولَٰئِكَ كَانَ عَنْهُ مَسْئُولًا You would be held responsible and liable for the claims you make. My eye has seen, my heart has thought, my ears have heard. Understand, be circumspect before you pronounce. And the second thing is, كَانَ قَلْبِي سَلِيمًا لِلْمُسْلِمِينَ My heart has never ever entertained or harbored negativity, jealous or antagonism or hostility for any human or any Muslim throughout my life. And I invest my hopes in that. That which was the average state of this Sahabi is not my spiritual state on the occasion of Hajj at the plains of Arafat. Is not my state on the 27th of Ramadan when I'm holding onto the cloth of the Kaaba and I'm screaming out for aid and assistance. Even at that time, my heart is brimming with this pride and this arrogance in me. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiyallahu anhu used to say, the Muslim Ummah, when they see another brother or another organization or some amongst them that are going through difficulties or hardship, then they do not start clapping hands on the fall of others. إِذَا رَأَيْتُمْ أَخَاكُمْ قَارَفَ دَنْبًا فَلَا تَكُونُوا أَعْوَانًا لِلشَّيْطَانِ عَلَيْهِ. When you see your brother is going through some turmoil, some difficulty, he's been put under some scrutiny, microscopically he's been analyzed, financially or otherwise, do not aid the campaign of the devil against him by saying, it's good, it's about time. They need to feel the hiding. They need to be exposed. They need to go to the cleaners. وَلَكِنْ سَلُوا اللَّهَ الْعَافِيَةِ. But at that time, you should be intensifying your prayer of protection. Oh Allah, I never thought it could happen to this country. Allah, I never thought it could happen to this individual. Allah, I never thought this organization could collapse. Allah, give me safety. Allah, give me protection. Allah, give me assistance. The Quran tells Sayyidina Nuh that when you board the ark and you see those that have revolted and rebel are drowning, then at that time it's not for you to clap hands. فَإِذَا اسْتَوَيْتَ أَنْتَ وَمَنْ مَعَكَ عَلَى الْفُلْكِ فَقُلِ الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ الَّذِي نَجَّانَا مِنَ الْقَوْمِ الظَّالِمِينَ. As you see them collapsing, oh my Lord, I'm grateful that with your intervention and your clemency and your mercy, you've rescued me and you've separated me. Otherwise, my lot could be the very much same, if not worse. Look at the political landscape of the world and look at the turbulence and the anarchy and the mayhem. How can you and I slip into a zone of comfort? How can we fall into the lap of complacency and feel all is hunky-dory for me in any way, shape or size? Then Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiyallahu anhu said, فَإِنَّا أَصْحَابُ مُحَمَّدٍ كُنَّا لَا نَقُولُ فِي أَحَدٍ شَيْئًا حَتَّى نَعْلَمْ عَلَى مَا يَمُوتُ. We the companions of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we would be very calculated and measured when it came to pronouncing judgments on individuals or organizations. We would think 10 times. They say the one who thinks before speaking, the one who speaks without thinking, the one who speaks without thinking runs a greater risk than the one who thinks without speaking. The one who speaks without thinking, he runs a greater risk than the one who thinks without speaking. You're thinking, you're in thinking mode. This is the time to speak less. When Sayyidina Hussein radiyallahu anhu was assassinated, right? This was a very, very sad day in the annals of Islamic history. And we know this, and it's a great story, and it's a very sad moment, and it's a very tragic thing, and there are great things that have been written about it. But Rabi ibn Khuthaym, the other day I read an amazing quotation of his, and I have a flash of this. And then I will share with you what I wanted to say. He said, the problem with the world today is, and he said it back in his time, إِنَّ النَّاسَ خَافُ اللَّهَ فِي ذُنُوبِ الْعِبَادِ وَلَمْ يَخَافُ اللَّهَ فِي ذُنُوبِ أَنفُسِهِمْ. He said, today I am fearing Allah on your behalf. And brother, you living a life like this, really, I don't want to meet my creator like this. I don't know how you go to sleep. Oh, I wouldn't want to spend one night like this. How do you live a life like this? I wouldn't want to die meeting my creator in the state in which you are. So I'm very bold in fearing Allah on behalf of others. But I never fear Allah on behalf of my own wrong. I never think how I'm living my life. How am I living my life? When Sayyidina Hussein radiallahu anhu was assassinated and people came to ask him for a verdict and a press release and can we have a statement? And they said, today he will open up. Today he will speak. Today he will vent. And then he said, "Ah, awaqad fa'alu? Have they literally assassinated this great man, Hussein radiallahu anhu? Allahumma fatir as-samawati wal-ard, alim al-ghayb wal-shahada, anta tahkumu bayna ibadika fima kanu fihi yakhtalifun. Allah, you the creator of the heavens and the earth, you regulate it, you'll decide on the day of Qiyamah." That's my statement. So we, the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we would never make premature judgments. We would never be hasty in concluding issues. Why? Hatta na'lam ala ma yamut. Until we see the outcome. Because life has its turbulences, has its fluctuations, until we see the state in which the man passes away. فَإِنْ عَلِمْنَا أَنْ فَإِنْ خُتِمَ لَهُ بِخَيْرٍ عَلِمْنَا أَنَّهُ قَدْ أَصَابَ خَيْرًا. If we see a noble end and a pleasant end, then we say those are loud indications that this man was enjoyed a good relation with Allah. وَإِنْ خُتِمَ بِشَرٍ خِفْنَا عَلَيْهِ. And Allah forbid if the man had a nasty ending, had a wicked ending, and really he just came sliding down and just went on a slope from prominence to acceptance. Suddenly he dips down to embarrassment, to humiliation, to disgrace, and then off the radar and off the navigation and never to be seen. And then the man is in a pitiful and an appalling state. Even in a state like that, we would not pronounce the judgment, but we would become very nervous and apprehensive about such individual's fate in Akhirah. There's a beautiful incident mentioned in the 24th juz in Surah Hamim and Hawamim, as Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu has referred to it as Dibajul Quran, the silk of the Quran. That one day Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu was sitting with his companions, and then he rotated his gaze and he said, "There's a youngster that used to be attending my gathering, I don't see him." And he was very talented, he was very robust, he was very muscular, he was very skilled. Lahu za'irun ka za'ir al-asad, he had the roar of a lion. So someone said, "Umar, close the chapter and move on. The man has indulged in social evils and unfortunately he's got a drinking habit. So you know what, don't even bother yourself and move on." Umar said, "No, no, he's part of us. And why should we continue indulging or engaging in a supposed program when one of our members have defected? When one of our members are in a crisis? We've got to respond to his aid, we've got to stand out." So Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu then gave it thought and he wrote a verse. And a verse of the 24th juz, and that's what Ibn Kathir has captured in his tafsir, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala introduces himself by saying, غافر الذنب وقابل التوب شديد العقاب ذي الطول لا إله إلا هو إليه المصير. Allah is one who pardons, who accepts repentance, yet full of might and authority. Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu writes from Umar to so and so, writes this ayah, and then he gives it to a person and he says, "Do me a favor, go to this particular brother of mine who unfortunately is in this crisis. If I have to discover that so-and-so has fallen, that's the gossip, that's the social afternoon. It just adds flavor to the barbecue. It's just excitement. It's just, you know what, oh, go for the run and enjoy when, where, how, what, who." Sayyidina Umar halted his program, got them activated, mobilized his team, captured this in writing, tasked one person as an envoy. He said, "You take this note and you go and give it to this man. But two things. You give it to him personally. If you don't meet him, you don't give it to anyone else." This is confidentiality. This is confidentiality. We need to trust and respect that. Number one. Number two, you give it to him when he's sober and he's in a state that he can read it. If you find that unfortunately he's not sober, he's not in his senses, then you wait till he recovers, and when he's in a good state, you drop him the note. The envoy takes this note, light as it is, laden with prayer and supplication, brimming with concern and worry. He then addresses his congregation and he said, "Ud'u Allah li akhikum an yuqbila bi qalbihi." Now I'm not going to have a program. We've changed our program. Every one of you now engage in passionate prayer that when this note drops in the lap of our brother, it must effect a positive change. And Allah must inspire his heart to embrace the bold step of change. So it's just not a lousy SMS. It's just not a simple text. It's just not sending an email. It's filled with meaning. فلما بلغ الرجل كتاب عمر, when the note of Umar falls in the lap of this man, جعل يقرأه ويردده ويبكي. He started reading it, reflecting, introspecting and tearing. And he said, Umar, I salute your vision. I salute your choice. What a verse from the entire Quran. You're giving me hope and you're chastising me. You're inspiring me with a glimmer of hope and you're rebuking me. نزع فأحسن النزع. He then repented and became one of the most rehabilitated youth Medina had ever seen. And then Sayyidina Umar said, my lesson for today is this. إذا رأيتم أخا لكم زل زلة فسددوه ووثقوه ولا تكونوا أعوانا للشيطان عليه. That when you see your brother fall, then stand up to rescue him, save him. Let him not fall on the ground, because his fall is the collapse of the entire ummah. And rescuing him is the rescue and the deliverance of the entire ummah. And that brings me to the great quotation of Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu. Imagine a day can come where somebody comes to my organization and says, brother, I have X amount of funds. And I say, you know what, may Allah bless you. Actually, you know what, we have sufficient funds. But there is another organization close by. They are in a dire need. Please, do you want to just refer your funds there? Helping them and helping us is helping the cause of deen. Imagine when we will operate with broadness of shoulders like that. And that is the way we will complement and not contradict. Where will this ummah move? Abdullah ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu, someone insulted him. He said, you know, Allah has given me three things which are exclusive to me. And I doubt anyone else in the ummah has it. Number one, إِنِّي لَآتِي عَلَى الْآيَةِ فَأَوَدُّ لَوْ أَنَّ النَّاسَ جَمِيعًا عَلِمُوا مِثْلَ الَّذِي أَعْلَمُ. When I study a verse and then Allah has favored me with the depth, the profoundness, the understanding, the intricacy, the sciences of the Quran, my heart screams out. And I don't want to have a monopoly over this. And I don't want to be the first one who tweeted this. And I don't want to be the first one who coined this phrase. I want the whole world to know it like how I know it, and we share from what Allah has given us all. Imam Shafi said, I wish people can take the knowledge I have disseminated without directing or attributing a letter to me. Without directing or attributing a letter to me. Number two, وَإِنِّي لَأَسْمَعُ بِالْحَاكِمِ مِنْ حُكَّامِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ يَقْضِي بِالْعَدْلِ. Sometimes I will hear of a governor and a ruler who's executing justice, and I'm ecstatic and I'm elated that one man has been appointed in a prominent post and he is delivering in relation to the task that is resting on his shoulders. وَلَعَلِّي لَا أُقَاضِي إِلَيْهِ أَبَدًا. And it's not like I've got vested interest with the man. I won't meet him, I won't see him. But just to know a man has been appointed in a particular institution who's executing goodness and bringing good to the people, it brings me the same joy as if it was happening in my home. Number three, وَإِنِّي لَأَسْمَعُ بِالْغَيْثِ أَصَابَ الْبَلَدِ مِنْ بِلَادِ الْمُسْلِمِينَ فَأَفْرَحُ بِهِ وَمَالِي بِتِلْكَ الْأَرْضِ سَائِمَةَ أَيْ دَبَّةٌ تَرْعَى. I will hear about rain that comes down and then it will drench the land and the animals will graze and vegetation will grow. And I'm not aware of the shepherds of that land, nor of the vegetation, nor of the landscape. But just to know the rain of Allah benefited the bondsman of Allah. For me, it is like rain benefited my own crops and I'm eating of it. Musnad Ahmad, there is a narration when the Sahaba migrated from Mecca and they came to Medina. So the Ansar, they poured their hearts out and they displayed unprecedented hospitality. So for a moment, the Muhajirin felt that, you know what? They stole the show. They took everything. I wonder if I'll get any reward. They said, Ya Rasulallah, khashina an yadhhabu bil ajri kulli. The way they have served us, we afraid there's no reward left. Whereas they were the migrants. They had to forsake their native land. They had to give up their luxuries, their embellishments and their comforts. But they looked at the overwhelming hospitality and they said, I doubt there's any reward for us. And he sallallahu alayhi wasallam gave such a profound formula. Just to contextualize this here, the incident of the Ansar was so phenomenal. And that's what I'm saying, the ummah is in dire need for broad shoulders. The ummah is in a desperate need to rise beyond. When I get personal with my wife and she gets personal with me, the kids are suffering. The children, the next day there isn't food in the house and the children's routine has been completely, you know what, distracted and has been completely put in chaos and disarray simply because of the argument of the parents. And if I bicker with you and you bicker with me, the children of this ummah are just been left and unattended to. The institutions of this ummah are just been left and abused and exploited, and the list can continue and continue. So when the spoils of Banu Nadir were brought in, and Allah makes reference of this in Surah Hashr,
هُوَ الَّذِي أَخْرَجَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا مِنْ أَهْلِ الْكِتَابِ مِنْ دِيَارِهِمْ لِأَوَّلِ الْحَشْرِ مَا ظَنَنْتُمْ أَنْ يَخْرُجُوا وَظَنُّوا أَنَّهُمْ مَانِعَتُهُمْ حُصُونُهُمْ مِنَ اللَّهِ.
That they were very well fortified and insulated. So when the spoils of Banu Nadir came, reflect for a moment that this is amazing. This is what we should be aspiring for. So here are the migrants that came from Mecca to Medina, and then comes this handsome booty that falls in the lot of the Muslims, and it is fay, and the final line between fay and ghanimat academically is mal ghanimat, and the wealth of booty is that in which the warriors have actively participated, so they have a due that is allotted to them. While fay, literally if you dissect it, it means it has returned, it has come back to you without active battle, so there's no stipulated share for the warriors. It's at the discretion of the Master Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam or his leaders who succeed him. And this is a whole academic, and I don't want to go into the finer writings on all this. So the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam has all the spoils of war, rich legacy, great wealth, and now comes the aspect of the dispensation and the sensitivity of dispensing this wealth. So he gathers the Muhajirin and he gathers the Ansar, and he says, hang on folks, we've got all this wealth, and every person inherently, intrinsically, we are attached to wealth. وَإِنَّهُ لِحُبِّ الْخَيْرِ لَشَدِيدٍ. That is why when wealth came in, Sayyidina Umar used to say, oh Allah, I am not amongst those who say I don't want to love wealth, because I do love it. I'm amongst those who ask you, inspire me to channel it where it pleases you. Oh Allah, I love wealth. That is why someone said zuhud, which is abstinence. What is the definition of zuhud? Zuhud doesn't mean that you mustn't possess the world, but rather it means the world mustn't possess you. So own it, but let it not possess you. So anyway, the Prophet ﷺ gathered the Muhajirin and the Ansar. He said to the Ansar, these people are dependent on you financially, morally, socially, otherwise. If I take this entire chunk and I give it to the migrants and I exclusively channel it to them, and in doing so, I release their dependence from you. So on a subtle note, I'm giving you as well. Directly I will be giving them, but I will be liberating them and freeing them from your dependence. Are you people fine with the idea? If I throw this around, you want to sit down, you want to brainstorm, you want to deliberate, you want to come back to me. Is this okay with you? So they all said, it sounds good and we're happy with it. Sa'd bin Mu'adh radiallahu anhu, one of the leaders of the Ansar, stood up. He said, O Nabi of Allah, I just want to add to your vision. I just want to take it slightly further. Perfect, I'm in harmony with your sentiments. Whatever wealth came, imagine, you supported, you were there in crisis, you gave your home. Come the time of dispensing, comes the time of affluence, all the wealth has been given to the migrants, and you are being not marginalized or not discriminated, but you've been kept aside. O Nabi of Allah, that's fine. Give everything to our Muhajirin brothers. But one thing I would like to add to your suggestion, don't detach them from us, leave them still with us, so they continue the perks of sharing my home, my conveyance, my allowance, my finances, and give them all the wealth of the Banu Nadir exclusively. Subhanallah, when I read this the first time, by Allah, I cried. I said, this is the benchmark of the believer. This is the precedent Sahaba said. فَإِنْ آمَنُوا بِمِثْلِ مَا آمَنْتُمْ بِهِ فَقَدْ اِهْتَدَوْا. Tell them to produce the level of submission, unity and brotherhood that the Sahaba did. Now when Sa'd bin Mu'adh radiallahu anhu did this, we were like, Sa'd, speak for yourself. O Prophet of Allah, he doesn't necessarily amplify the sentiments of the broader community. He's speaking in his individual capacity. Everyone said, oh, the Prophet of Allah, we conquer with the sentiments.
And I read this in Tabaqat ibn Sa'd, when Sa'd bin Mu'adh radiyallahu anhu was in his fatal illness and he was about to pass away. What more do you need in your cap? What greater feather do you need? Then the Prophet of Allah coming to Sa'd radiyallahu anhu, وَهُوَ يَجُودُ بِنَفْسِهِ, as he's about to take his last breath, and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, جَزَاكَ اللَّهُ خَيْرًا مِنْ سَيِّدِ قَوْمٍ أَنْجَزْتَ مَا وَعَدْتَ اللَّهَ وَلَيُنْجِزَنَّكَ اللَّهُ مَا وَعَدَكَ. Oh my words. Oh Sa'd, I don't have a long story to tell you. I just want to tell you, you've been a phenomenal leader who led this ummah. You've been a phenomenal leader who led this ummah. Not my words, not your words, the words of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Jazakallahu khayran min sayyidi qawmin anjazta ma wa'adta Allah. You diligently complied to the proclamations and the vows you made when you took office. When you came up, you lived up, you delivered. وَلَيُنْجِزَنَّكَ اللَّهُ مَا وَعَدَكَ. Let your eyes close and see how Allah delivers to you.
وَلَسَوْفَ يُعْطِيكَ رَبُّكَ فَتَرْضَى. وَلَسَوْفَ يُعْطِيكَ رَبُّكَ فَتَرْضَى.
Allah speaking about Sayyidina Abu Bakr that he gave for the pleasure of Allah. Allah said, I will give him till he is pleased. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam paid tribute to the Ansar. He said, مَا يَضُرُّ إِمْرَأَةً نَزَلَتْ بَيْنَ أَبَوَيْهَا أَوْ نَزَلَتْ بَيْنَ بَيْتَيْنِ مِنَ الْأَنْصَارِ. If a Ansari woman puts up at her parents' house or she knocks any Ansari door, she's given equal hospitality at any average house or the house of her parents. That was the bond and that was the brotherhood that was found amongst the Ansar. So here is a very volatile period in our history. When Sayyidina Hassan radiallahu anhu has taken the reins of the Khilafat, and there is a strong pulling, and there is a strong campaign, and there is a sizable audience, and people have been mobilized who feel that this post is more deserving for Sayyidina Muawiyah radiallahu anhu. And make no mistake, Muawiyah radiallahu anhu, in addition to being the brother-in-law of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he was the scribe of revelation. Can you imagine the trust the Nabi of Allah had in him, that few were selected as katibin al-wahi, to capture and write and record wahi, and Sayyidina Muawiyah radiallahu anhu was amongst those people. So Sayyidina Hassan radiallahu anhu realized the volatility, and he realized the sensitivity, and he realized that this was creating a tremor in the ummah. So he took onto the minbar. 6 months into his khilafat, he said, after praising Allah, إِنَّ هَذَا الْأَمْرَ قَدْ سَلَّمْتُهُ لِمُعَاوِيَةً. Listen people, I openly announce to you, I relinquish my powers, and I dissolve my kingdom and my ruling, and I hand over the reins of this volatile leadership in this transitory phase to my brother and not my rival, Sayyidina Muawiyah radiallahu anhu. And then he goes on to say, I haven't done him a favor. إِمَّا أَن يَكُونَ حَقَّهُ. Perhaps he is the rightful custodian of this dominion in the eyes of Allah. فَأَخَذَ حَقَّهُ. Then he's only taken something which belongs to him. As much as I might view it, or my colleagues, or my friends, or my comrades might view that I'm the person, but if in the eyes of Allah he is the rightful man, أَخَذَ حَقَّهُ, he has taken his due. Or perhaps I am the rightful person. فَتَرَكْتُهُ لِصَلَاحِ أُمَّةِ مُحَمَّدٍ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ وَحَقْنِ دِمَائِهَا. And if in the eyes of Allah I am the rightful person, then I will not take him to task for this on the day of Qiyamah. I relinquish and dissolve this to save this ummah from further fragmentation, to rescue the vehicle of this ummah so the wheel of this ummah can continue turning. فَالْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ الَّذِي أَكْرَمَ بِنَا أَوَّلَكُمْ I'm grateful to Allah that He has used myself and my family in always mending this ummah and never dividing this ummah. So when he did this bold, this great, this amazing achievement, someone came to him and said to him, you've defeated us, you've ditched us, you've launched us, you have forsaken us. And he said, I no longer will refer to you as the leader of the believers, but you are an insult to the ummah. He said, you are not Amir al-Mu'mineen, you are Aar al-Mu'mineen. You're an insult. Sayyidina Hassan radiallahu anhu said words that we need to engrave in our hearts. He said, Al-Aar khayrun min al-Nar. Al-Aar khayrun min al-Nar. I can live with someone calling me a deserter. I can live with someone calling me nasty things. I can live with someone saying, I've lost the train and I've lost the plot and I've lost my focus, but I cannot contend with the blazing flames of hell. And I don't want to be the person of fragmenting this ummah. In fact, there's an amazing incident written. He had a half-brother, that is Muhammad ibn Ali, who shared a common mother, a common father to Hassan radiallahu anhu, but he didn't share a common mother because Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu had multiple spouses and partners. So one day Sayyidina Hassan and Sayyidina Ali had an altercation. And I think this is key that I must address this as well. When we saying that the ummah needs to unite and we need to stand together and pool our resources and understand our common spirit, I'm not for a moment suggesting that there won't be difference of opinion. That's bound to happen. And sometimes it can get ugly and it can get bitter and it can get personal. But like they say in English, lose if you have to lose, but don't lose the lesson. Lose if you have to lose, but don't lose the lesson. Emerge from that crisis one better. Emerge from that bickering one stronger. Then we are progressing, then we inching, then we leaping, then we advancing, otherwise we retrogressing. So Hassan radiallahu anhu had an argument and an altercation with his brother Muhammad bin Ali. So his brother wrote to him and he said, فَإِنَّ لَكَ شَرَفًا لَا أَبْلُغُهُ وَفَضْلًا لَا أُدْرِكُهُ. Listen, my brother, I must be honest, Allah has favored you way more than me. That's the beginning point, that I admit your excellency and your virtue over me. You are greater than me. You are greater than me. Allah has favored you. أَبُونَا عَلِيٌّ. We share a common father. لَا أُفَضِّلُكَ فِيهِ وَلَا تُفَضِّلُنِي فِيهِ. In the father we have, and in the ancestry we have, and in the lineage and the genealogy, you don't have any upper hand over me, I don't have any virtue over you. However, Ummuka Fatima radiallahu anha, but your mom is Fatima radiallahu anha. Fill the entire world with women like my mom. Ma wafayna bi ummik. Ma wafayna bi ummik. They cannot match the virtue of your mother. فَإِذَا قَرَأْتَ رُقْعَتِي هَذِهِ. When you receive this note of mine, فَالْبَسْ رِدَاءَكْ. Then clad yourself with your dress. فَتَعَالْ فَتَرَضِّنِي. And hasten and let us reconcile, because you have always surpassed me in virtue, and this is the one virtue I'm going to surpass you if you're not going to hasten. I mean, look at their engagement, look at their letters. It wasn't dirty, wasn't ugly, wasn't hostile, wasn't inflammatory, wasn't, you know, sometimes when people send text messages, you sit and think, did this man think before he pressed the green button? Brother, are you applying your mind? Do you know what you're saying? Do you understand the language you're using in it? And then against your own, in the blessed month of Ramadan, regarding the house of Allah, whatever it is, may Allah protect, may Allah save. So immediately Sayyidina Hassan radiallahu anhu stood up and he advanced. There's an incident mentioned, Ibn al-Munzir records it, that one day Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu had an argument with a person. And sometimes we slip up and we say things. So he said, Inni la ubghidhu fulanan. I've got a bone to pick with this man. I've got a contentious issue with him. And he irks me. He offends me. I don't like him. So Umar radiallahu anhu said it once, twice. Somebody took these sentiments and they went to him and he said, Ma sha'nu Umar yubghiduk. Brother, I see Umar radiallahu anhu differs with you and you and him are not on a common page. What's the issue? So few people came to him and said, Umar is not very happy and he despises you. So he came straight to Umar radiallahu anhu And he said, Umar, can I ask you a question, please? He said, go for it. Janaytu jinaya? Have I committed a crime? He said, no. Ahdathtu hadatha? Have I innovated any innovation in Islam? No. Fataqtu fatqa? Have I created a rift amongst the Muslims? No, not really. فَعَلَامَ تُبْغِذُنِي Then Umar, you have no license and no justification to despise me. Why do you constantly say things about me when I haven't hurt you, offended you, insulted you in any way? Remember Umar, I'm not going to leave you like this. The Quran says, and Allah openly declares, وَالَّذِينَ يُؤْذُونَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ وَالْمُؤْمِنَاتِ بِغَيْرِ مَا اكْتَسَبُوا فَقَدْ احْتَمَلُوا بُهْتَانًا وَإِثْمًا مُبِينًا Those who hurt the believers, insult the believers, they carry the burden of an accusation. And you've committed a grave crime. فَلَا غَفَرَ اللَّهُ لَكَ يَا عُمَرُ Umar, it is my prayer to Allah that Allah must never pardon you for this wrong that you've done to me. No one was to turn around, brother, who needs your du'as? The Nabi of Allah has said, the narration of Ibn Asakir, مَا مِن مَلَكٍ إِلَّا وَهُوَ يُوَقِّرُ عُمَرُ وَلَا فِي الْأَرْضِ الشَّيْطَانٌ إِلَّا وَهُوَ يَفْرُقُ مِنْ عُمَرُ The Nabi of Allah said, I haven't yet met an angel that doesn't salute Umar. And I haven't yet seen a devil that's not afraid of Umar. So Umar had to just flash that card. Brother, for the record sake, the Nabi of Allah said this, who needs you? No, I cried. Umar held on to him. Umar begged him. Umar beseeched him. Umar implored him. He said, my brother, I'll do anything in my means to clear this dislike in your heart. Don't jeopardize my entry into Jannah. A man like Umar, who didn't need the pardon of one person to secure his entry for the multiple accolades that he had. How many thousands of people are cursing nasty things to me because of my provocative behavior, because of my inconsistency. How is this going to reconcile on the day of Qiyamah when I appear before Allah? And when I make this translation of Umar, it's not a thumbsuck and it's not a shot in the dark. It is paraphrasing the Arabic word فَلَمْ يَزَلْ بِهِ فَلَمْ يَزَلْ بِهِ in Arabic means Umar hanged on to him. Umar hanged on to him till you don't forgive, I won't leave. حَتَّى غَفَرَ لَهُ He said, okay, Umar, I am convinced and I'm ready to reconcile with you so that you can move forward. Subhanallah. The point that I'm trying to stress here and say is that these differences, these bickerings are inevitable. We cannot expect that it's going to be hiccup-free. What we are asking is rise beyond and have the broad shoulders and embrace the good of one another and move forward. So here is yet another sensitive issue that comes in our history, and that is the narration has been captured in Hayatul Sahaba and other books of hadith as well. Raja ibn Rabi'a says, we were sitting in a gathering. You know, there is another incident that comes to mind. Ibn Asakir has mentioned this and I've read it myself, that some Sahaba say we were gone out in a campaign to Iraq. And we were victorious while we were in Iraq. And when we returned, we came with some beautiful dress from that place and some beautiful sweet meat and delicacies that were given to us. So we returned, we clad ourselves with this exclusive dress and we came and immediately we reported back to headquarters to meet with the leader of the believers, Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu. فَأَعْرَضَ عَنَّا بِوَجْهِهِ Umar radiallahu anhu turned his face away and he gave us a cold shoulder. We returned. We were tired, we were exhausted, we performed, we delivered, we achieved. Really, we didn't need this type of reception when we got back. In our understanding, it was uncalled for. But anyway, this was Sahaba. It was not my personal motive. It was looking at the cause of deen. So immediately they went to Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu and they said, Abdullah, you would understand your dad better than us. We returned, we were all excited and elated. We went to Sayyidina Umar. He gave us a cold shoulder. He said, إِنَّ أَمِيرَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ رَآ عَلَيْكُمْ لِبَاسًا لَمْ يَرَ رَسُولَ اللَّهِ صَلَى اللَّهِ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَمْ يَلْبَسُهُ The reality is, the way I understand my dad, he seen you clad in a dress that he had never seen the Nabi of Allah wearing this. Hence, he couldn't digest the sight because it was alien and foreign to him.
So you want to go back, change your clothes, and I'm sure things would be much better for you. Now they didn't say, but what's so wrong with it? But end of the day, we went, but we entitled, but who said, but what's the logistics? What's the dynamics? What's the democracy? No, no, no. They were out to change and help. They were out to improve and better. So they went immediately without arguing the whole scenario. They remove their clothing and they wear their regular dress and they come back. And then Umar embraces them with such a warm embrace as if nothing unpleasant had occurred prior to this. That just means they did not represent their egos, they represented the deen. I don't have anything personal between me and you, my brother. It's the deen of Allah and that's it. Then they presented Sayyidina Umar with these beautiful delicacies. Fadaqahu, he tasted it. He said, that's enough for me, move it aside. He said, must I predict something? They said, go for it. He said, لَيَقْتُلَنَّ مِنْكُمُ الْإِبْنُ أَبَاهُ وَالْأَخُ أَخَاهُ عَلَىٰ هَذَا الطَّعَامُ. I foresee a bleak era coming your way where a son will slay his father for food like this and a brother will kill his sibling to eat delicacies like this. I don't want to involve myself in food like this. Feed someone else. I foresee an era where a son will slay his dad, his biological dad. And a brother will kill his sibling to procure and secure delicacies like this. And he said, give it to those, whose parents were the veterans and who were martyred in the early days of Islam. Perhaps their descendants and their offspring are the most deserving and not people like myself. So anyway, Raja ibn Rabi'ah makes mention of this narration. And he says, we were sitting and with us was Abu Sa'id Khudri radiallahu anhu. And just then, Hassan radiallahu anhu passes by. Now understand, Hassan was this great Sahabi, the grandson of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. You know, there are multiple accolades that we can enumerate of the great Sahabi Hassan radiallahu anhu. So he passes by and Hassan radiallahu anhu said, Assalamu alaykum wa rahmatullah. فَرَدَّ عَلَيْهِ الْقَوْمِ. So Abu Sa'id Khudri and other Sahaba, they all said, وَعَلَيْكُمُ السَّلَامُ وَرَحْمَةُ اللَّهِ وَبَرَكَاتُهُ. But we didn't hear an audible response from Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu anhu. When Hassan radiallahu anhu moved forward, أَتْبَعَهُ أَيْ بِبَصَرِهِ. Then Abdullah ibn Umar focused his gaze towards Hassan radiallahu anhu, and from the rear, very softly he said, وَعَلَيْكُمُ السَّلَامُ وَرَحْمَةُ اللَّهِ. And then he addressed us and he said, أَلَا أُنَبِّئُكُمْ بِأَحَبِّ أَهْلِ الْأَرْضِ إِلَىٰ أَهْلِ السَّمَاءِ. Must I not share with you that individual on this earth who is most beloved in the eyes of Allah? قُلْنَا بَلَىٰ. We said, please don't keep this a secret and go forward and tell us. He said, the very gentleman who has walked past, he is the most beloved to Allah. وَاللَّهِ مَا كَلَّمَنِي كَلِمَةً وَلَا كَلَّمْتُهُ كَلِمَةً مُنْدُ لَيَالِي صِفِّينَ. Tragically and unfortunately, myself and him, due to some differences, have not exchanged a polite word from the battle of Siffin. And it's been a long time. وَلَا أَن يَرْضَى عَنِّي. But if somebody can be bold enough to reconcile this relation today, I will be the happiest man the earth has ever seen. وَلَا أَن يَرْضَى عَنِّي أَحَبُّ إِلَيَّ. And if somebody can just facilitate this and reconcile this and create this muhabba between us, I'm ecstatic, I'm done. The thing that I'm waiting for in this world to happen is done for me and it's over. So Abu Sa'id Khudri radiallahu anhu said, أَلَا نَقُومُ فَنَعْتَذِرْ. If that's your passion, then let's stand up, go to him, apologize and reconcile. Now if I say this, that I want to reconcile, and somebody say, let's go. No, no, I don't mean like that. Yeah, inshallah, one day, look here, when we go for Hajj, you never know, Allah can unite us there. You see, that's unfortunately our type of thinking. As the Quran says, بَلْ يُرِيدُ الْإِنسَانُ لِيَفْجُرَ أَمَامَهُ. بَلْ يُرِيدُ الْإِنسَانُ لِيَفْجُرَ أَمَامَهُ يَسْأَلُ أَيَّانَ يَوْمُ الْقِيَامَةِ.
نقوم فنعتذر. Let's stand up and go to Hassan رضي الله عنه and apologize. That's what you want to do. He said, yeah, let's go. Now, can you imagine how difficult that moment is if you're not in speaking terms, and then you end up at the traffic light and you roll your window down and oops, here's the brother. Or you walk into the aisle and then subhanAllah, here's the brother you bump into and you're like trying to duck behind invisible pillars. And you're creating these pillars to take shelter because you don't know where to hide yourself. These are the types of things we do. But because the hearts were clean. So they go and Abu Sa'id Khudri radiallahu anhu fasta'dhan, he asked Hassan radiallahu anhu, can I come in? He said, yeah, please come in. He said, I have a guest with me. Can I usher him in? Can we welcome him? So Hassan radiallahu anhu said, and who's your guest? He said, Abdullah ibn Umar. He said, wow, that's great. He said, yes, I've got Abdullah ibn Umar. My word, please, bring him in. We sat down. Who breaks the ice? Who makes the bold statement? Where do we start? We're like, these are the type of gestures we'll do. No, you tell him, no, don't say this. No. So Abu Sa'id, this is what the Quran said, Sahaba were أَقَلُّهُمْ تَكَلُّفَا. They didn't harbor any formalities. قُلْ مَا أَسْأَلُكُمْ عَلَيْهِ مِنْ أَجْرٍ وَمَا أَنَا مِنَ الْمُتَكَلِّفِينَ أي وَمَا أَنَا مِنَ الْمُتَصَنِّعِينَ. Say unto them, I don't ask for any compensation on my message. And I'm not from amongst those who act and pretend. I'm not from amongst those who act and pretend. I say it, I do it. I claim it, I deliver it. So we sat down. Abu Sa'id then looked at Abdullah ibn Umar and he said, حَدِّثْنَا بِالَّذِي حَدَّثْتَنَا حَيْثُ مَرَّ الْحَسَنِ. Subhanallah. He said, listen, Abdullah ibn Umar, you just want to remind us when Hassan radiallahu anhu walked past, you were paying tribute to the man. You just want to remind us what you said? Simple, beautiful, go to the point, reconcile. When the man passed by, you just want to say what he said? Now what did I say? What's the sign of a jealous man? وَذِي حَسَدٍ يَغْتَابُنِي حَيْثُ لَا يَرَى مَكَانِي وَيُثْنِي صَالِحًا حَيْثُ أَسْمَعُ. That when we sit in together, then he praises me. And in my absence, he speaks ill of me. And when we say it's wrong to speak ill of someone in his absence, it doesn't for a moment mean it's correct to speak ill of people in their presence. Because the Quran negates that. وَيْلٌ لِكُلِّ هُمَزَةٍ لُمَزَةٍ. Woe be to those who speak ill of people in their presence and in their absence. So sometimes we say, no, me, I'll tell him behind his back and I'll tell him on his face also. That compounds the crime and doesn't lessen the offense. That's sheer ignorance, if not arrogance. He said, حَدِّثْنَا بِالَّذِي حَدَّثْتَنَا. Tell us what you said when Hassan radiallahu anhu passed by. He said, yes, basically I said, إِنَّهُ أَحَبُّ أَهْلِ الْأَرْضِ إِلَىٰ أَهْلِ السَّمَاءِ. I say it and I say it again. I said, on the entire earth, there isn't a soul more beloved to Allah than this very man, Hassan radiallahu anhu. So Hassan radiallahu anhu then took exception and he looked at Abdullah ibn Umar. He said, فَلِمَ قَاتَلْتَنَا يَوْمَ سِفِّينَ. If you believe I'm the noblest and I'm the best, then why did you unsheath your sword against me and my dad in the battle of Siffin? If this is your belief about me, then why did you withdraw your sword against me? But like I said, Sahaba, فَقَاتِلُهُمْ وَقَتِيلُهُمْ. Both of them were amazing. Every one of them were amazing. Every one of them were unique in their own ways. He said, allow me the opportunity not to justify my situation, but to explain my sequence of events. So he said, go for it. He said, إِنَّ عَمْرًا شَكَانِي إِلَىٰ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ. My dad, Amr ibn As, had lodged a complaint in the court of Nabi sallallahu alayhi wasallam. And again, when I read this, I cry. And I cry because this was such a pleasant complaint. You might find difficulty in reconciling with my words. How can it be a complaint and how can it be pleasant? It doesn't gel, it doesn't tie. But this is the reality of it. He said, my dad had complained and I wish today I had that complaint. And I wish the complaints of the guardians and the parents and the custodians were this complaint. So what was the complaint of my dad to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Inna amran yasumu an-nahar wa yaqumu al-layl. Oh Nabi of Allah, I need to talk to you. It's like every masjid I go to, wherever you walk out, Sheikh, I need to have a minute with you. My son, this one, that issue. Which home is free from it? We know the rebellion nature, the revolting nature, the arrogance of the youth that is just coming out and unfortunately has permeated the whole body. And in every way you see that arrogance, Allah guide and protect one and all. Someone said, we only have youth once, because that's all society can handle. And somebody said, what's the definition, or what's the key to success, according to the youth of today? The one that fits the ignition. What's the key to success by the definition of the youth of today? The one that fits the ignition. It's all about cars, it's all about materialism, it's all about amassing, and that's about it. So my dad had lodged a complaint, and what was the complaint? My dad told the Prophet of Allah, oh Prophet of Allah, my son Amr, he prays the whole night and he observes fast every day. Please speak to him, man, he cannot pray so much. Ya Subhanallah. Once upon a time, this was the complaint of the guardians about their youth. Where was our legacy? And what were our rich days? And where has this ummah stooped today? Where parents are complaining, negotiate with my child to at least offer his Jummah prayers. Speak to my child. I went to visit some elderly aunts of mine and my wife's after Ramadan. And you know, I said, Subhanallah, we need to strike the balance. Past in the late 80s. And then they said, you know, I don't have the strength anymore and I'm unable to observe my 6 fasts of Shawwal. And I feel so terrible about this. I did it in my youth. And I consoled them and I said, the Prophet ﷺ said, إِذَا مَرِضَ الْعَبْدُ أَوْ سَافَرْ كُتِبَ لَهُ مِثْلُ مَا كَانَ يَعْمَلُ صَحِيحًا مُقِيمًا. That when you age and you become senile and you become frail and weak, then Allah captures and records for you all the good actions you did in your youth. So take solace. You did it when you were young and active and healthy. The reward will continue. But there's this regret and this remorse. So I said, this is the gulf we got. Those that are exempted are lamenting that they don't have the ability. And on the other hand, we have this young man who's throwing out his zest and his zeal, who's throwing out his might and his power, and he's oblivious of the obligatory and mandatory fast of Ramadan. And the consequences are catastrophic and grave. And we have an old-aged, frail woman who's lamenting that she's unable to observe the optional fast. Like, what has happened to this ummah? So then the Prophet of Allah looked at me and he said, Sum wa aftir wa salli wa nam. Listen, Amr, listen to your dad. Listen to your dad. And you need to pray, offer the nocturnal prayer and sleep. And sometimes fast and sometimes eat. Wa ati' amran wa ati' amran. But whatever happens, listen to your dad. So those words were embedded in my heart. Those words were ringing in my ears. When it came to the occasion of Siffin, aqsama alayya, my dad looked at me and he said, Abdullah, you're joining me. And I just remembered the Nabi of Allah said, don't ever violate the sentiments of your dad. So I tied the two and I came on the battlefield. Wallahi ma kathartu lahum sawada, wala akhtaratu lahum sayfa, wala ta'antu bi rumhin, wala ramaytu bi sahmin. But trust me, Hassan radiallahu anhu, I respect you, I honor you. I only stood on that battlefield purely in compliance to the sentiments of my dad, because the Nabi of Allah had impressed upon me to do so. I did not add to their numbers. I did not unsheath my sword. I did not release my arrow. I did not pierce my spear. So then Hassan radiallahu anhu said, Ama alimta annahu la ta'ata li makhluqin fi ma'siyat al-khaliq. All said and done. But you know the golden rule, there is no submission to the creation at the cost of disobeying the creator. I said, precisely, and I am apologizing for this. And he begged, ka'annahu qabila minhu, until the relation was reconciled and the relation was then amended. Imagine a man like Abdullah ibn Umar radiyallahu anhu, who enjoyed so many accolades, but he took the bold step to go forward, make the unity, make the peace and go forward. 2-3 incidents and then I wrap up. There is a narration in Darimi. It's mentioned under At-Tawbikh liman yatlubu al-ilma lighayri wajhi Allah. Severe warnings for those who are the custodians of organizations, who are the forerunners in terms of Islamic activities, what diluted agendas, what corrupted intentions, those who imbibe the sciences of this deen with polluted endeavors and diluted intentions as well. At-tawbih, chastisement. لمن يطلب العلم, for anyone and everyone who acquires the sciences of deen or engages in the dissemination of deen, لغير وجه الله, for any reason other than the happiness of Allah. And Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu's quotation has been mentioned there in Darami. He said, يا حملة العلم, oh those that are in charge of this ummah, oh those that are looking after this ummah. In Kitab al-Zuhud of Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, under the advisor Sayyidina Isa alayhi salam, he said an amazing thing. He said, those that are the leaders of this ummah, they pretty much like the salt to the food. When the food doesn't have taste, then you add salt to it to flavor it. But he said, when the salt has lost its taste, then how do you restore the taste of the food? When the salt itself has lost its taste, ya milhal ard, ya milhal Islam, oh the salt of the ummah, oh the guardians of the ummah, oh the custodians of the ummah, idha fasada at-ta'am aslahahu al-milh. When the food loses its taste, you flavor it lightly with salt. Wa idha fasada al-milh, but when the salt itself lost its taste, how do you restore flavor to this food? And really today, unfortunately, the salt has lost its taste. The salt has lost its flavor. Someone said, the biggest challenge the youth of today are facing is to emulate character without seeing any examples. The greatest challenge that is upon this young generation that have been unleashed and their talent has been thrown out is to tell them to mimic the ways of nobility without any examples. So we cannot even say, look up to that man, take solace from that man, be inspired by that man. There's just no direction. So Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu said, Ya hamlat al-ilmi i'malu bihi. Listen, discharge the obligation of the post that you are in. Convey the knowledge that Allah has given to you. فَإِنَّمَا الْعَالِمُ مَنْ عَلِمَ بِمَا عَمِلْ. He is a scholar, he is an ambassador who marries his claims with actions. This harmony between what he says and what he does. وَسَيَكُونُ أَقْوَامٌ. There will be many people who will come and claim. لَا يُجَاوِزُ تَرَاقِيَهُمْ. But the knowledge won't cross their collarbone. يُخَالِفُ عَمَلُهُمْ عِلْمَهُمْ وَتُخَالِفُ سَرِيرَتُهُمْ عَلَانِيَتَهُمْ. They will be blatant contradiction in their utterances and their actions. There will be gross discrepancy in their private and public life. I say this often in many of my talks where someone said, I consider every person better than me. When asked why, he said, because I assume he is a sinner and I know I am a sinner. You're a human, you're a mortal, fallibility is intrinsic to you, it's inherent, it's inborn. So I assume you sin, but I know I sin. لِأَنَّنِي عَلَى نَفْسِي مِنْ يَقِينٍ وَعَلَى النَّاسِ مِنْ ضَعْفٍ وَعَلَى النَّاسِ مِنْ ظَنٍّ. I assume, maybe you sin, you're a human, but I know I sin. That is why I often say the easiest way to deflate your ego when you are being praised and flattered is reflect over your sins. The man is praising me only because he's not aware of that private life of mine. If this man who's singing my praises knows that past of my life or that other side of my life, he would never be making those praises. And the testimony of this is when you heard your wife and your kids praising you. In fact, they object when others praise. Like I told you, you know, my children told me I must stop mentioning them in the talks, but I share them because it's real, right? So when my young son, once somebody, he was a very fond brother of mine, and he used to listen to me a lot, and I said, Sheikh, when my first child is born, I'm bringing him straight to you, and you got to do the tahniq. And from the clinic, I told my wife, she can go to, the baby can go to your parents afterwards, but first I'm going to Sheikh, and really he must bless the child. And so he comes home with his baby, newborn, and you know, still all weak and frail. And so my young son was there. He says, but dad, isn't the practice is you got to go to a pious man? I'm like, yeah, what's the problem? But you're not. Right? You're only praising me, my brother, because you don't know the other side of me. And we ask Allah never to reveal that to the world. We ask Allah never to reveal that to the world. Anyway, Sayyidina Ali radiallahu anhu said, there will be gross discrepancy in their public life and their private life. That is why when Salma bin Dinar, Abu Hazim, his son asked him, إِنَّ أَشْيَاخَنَا كَثِيرُونَ فَبِمَنْ نَقْتَدِي مِنْهُمْ. There's so many scholars, there's so many opinions. Who do we follow? He said, اِقْتَدِي بِمَنْ يَخَافُ اللَّهَ فِي ظَهْرِ الْغَيْبِ. Look for that scholar who fears Allah in his private capacity and hold on to him and honor his verdicts. And listen, my brother, when you need a triple bypass and heart surgery, you really try and track down that cardiac surgeon. And it's not easy to find him. And the waiting list is long. And the cost is exorbitant. But you wait your turn because you're going to put your heart before him. He's going to be operating on the table before you. So you track him down, and finally when you find him, you put your health case and your files and your reports and your x-rays before him, and you run with his expertise. You'll need to search for that scholar. And I'm sure you will find him, because the Quran has declared, Inna ibadi laysa laka alayhim sultan, that there will remain a sizable number from my servants that will never succumb to the provocation of the devil, will never surrender to the indoctrination or the injections of the devil. So this is a bold declaration of the Quran, which gives us solace that they will remain the pious till the end of times. So he said, وَسَيَكُونُ أَقْوَامٌ لَا يُجَاوِزُ تَرَقِيَهُمْ. It will cross their collarbone. And يُخَالِفُ عِلْمُهُمْ عَمَلَهُمْ وَتُخَالِفُ سَرِيرَتُهُمْ عَلَانِيَتَهُمْ يُبَاهِي بَعْضُهُمْ بَعْضًا. Their piety will be reduced to only braving and chanting their own slogans. We did this, we achieved this, we performed this, we delivered this, we like this, we like that. I'm like this, you down like, that's it. The entire essence of that individual, that movement, that organization would be harping on their achievements. يُبَاهِي بَعْضُهُمْ بَعْضًا حَتَّى أَنَّ الرَّجُلْ لَيَغْضَبُ عَلَى جَلِيسِهِ أَنْ يَجْلِسَ إِلَى غَيْرِهِ. They will become so obsessed with themselves that if one of their members, to use the phrase, defects and attends another gathering, they shun him and discard him. And they say, that's the end of you. You are no more part of us. We are no more part of you. Sayyidina Ali said, أُولَٰئِكَ لَا تَصْعَدُ أَعْمَالُهُمْ فِي مَجَالِسِهِمْ تِلْكَ إِلَى اللَّهِ. Those people's efforts, contributions, devotions, and all their piety will not even reach the heavens, never mind the court of acceptance. And really, my brother, Sayyidina Ali said, don't trivialize a good action, because if it is accepted, it cannot be insignificant. And don't boast about a great action, because if it's rejected, how can it be big? Wow. What did he say? Do not trivialize an action, because if that small action is accepted, كَيْفَ يَقِلُّ مَا يُتَقَبَّلُ. How can that be small which is accepted? And don't boast about something that's apparently big, because if it's rejected, how can it be big? If it's rejected, how can it be great? But if it's accepted, how can it be small? And nobody can pronounce who has ikhlas, that only Allah knows. You know, to say, you know, I'm not judging, but I can tell you that brother doesn't have ikhlas. Subhanallah. My brother, what are you up to? I'm like, yeah, brother, I doubt he's got ikhlas. Look here, I'm not saying about myself, but I think he doesn't have. Subhanallah. One, two incidents and we wrap up. To show you, those whose hearts are clean, the great reward. And those whose hearts are filled with malice, the catastrophic consequences and repercussions. So among the spouses of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, one of his elder spouses was Sauda bint Zam'a radiallahu anha. She was a woman of age compared to Aisha radiallahu anha, young, in her early ages. She was 18 when the Master sallallahu alaihi wasallam passed away. The Master sallallahu alaihi wasallam endeavored to maintain fairness between all his spouses to his level best. However, his heart would incline towards Aisha radiallahu anha, and that's no secret, it's known to everyone. Look at Sauda radiallahu anha. Look at Sauda radiallahu anha. One is to come and antagonize this. No, Nabi of Allah, I've been watching you. And women watch you very well, my brother. You know that better, right? Oh, Nabi of Allah, I've watched you. And I've observed. You know, husband and wife were having this discussion. So the husband says to his wife, the wife says to the husband, you are so insensitive. Every time I'm speaking, you're yawning as if I'm monotonous. I've observed you've been yawning 5 times. So he's like, my darling, I'm not yawning, I'm trying to say something. Every time I'm opening my mouth, it's an attempt to respond. It's not a yawn. Honestly, I'm not being boring, I'm trying to respond, but where do I get the chance? O Nabi of Allah, I've observed you. And I think it's as bright as the sun. You are very fond of your wife, Aisha radiallahu anha, who to Sauda radiallahu anha was as good as a daughter, not a co-wife. The age discrepancy was big, great, decades, years apart. Sauda radiallahu anha featured amongst the elderly, noble, honorable consorts, while our mother Aisha Ummul Mu'mineen radiallahu anhuma was the younger of the spouses of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I've observed this year, and I have made peace with the fact that you love her more, and I'm happy with that. And I'm happy for her that this luck has fallen on her lap. I don't want to antagonize my relation with you, and I don't want to get personal and bicker and petty and sensitive about this. I've realized this, and I'm a woman of age. I've moved past and beyond the age where I have the physical need of a man. I am hereby handing over my due and my right that you owe me to visit me to my co-wife Aisha radiallahu anha. My brother, do you know what that is? A, in an average circumstances, a woman doesn't part with a recipe. I don't know, here, maybe here they're generous, good luck. But by and large, they give a recipe with one ingredient short, so that the cake flops. And then you come back and say, you know what, she's got the magical hand. She's got this hand about it. We need to go back to her. What kind of butter you use? No, you can use any butter. Your oven? Oh, any oven. I can't spell that to you, right? I can't spell that to you. Because if I spell that to you, then everybody has my secret. Furthermore, sitting in the company of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, every moment is years of ibadat. But she decided to rise beyond. Listen, my brother, you have greater ability than me. May Allah reward you. I wish you well. Yeah, you take in charge. You go forward. Let's see how it's not a matter of me challenging you or you winning me. It's how the deen of Allah goes forward. And how we can come and appear before on the day of Qiyamah, that our get together here today, these hundreds at this late hour, how can this turn to be fruitful and meaningful in the court of Allah? And that is why I often say, I envy my audience much more than myself. Because I can be standing here with 1,000 polluted intentions. But it's very difficult for a listener to have a corrupted intention. I can be standing here with arrogance. I can be standing here to sit and show my oratory skills and I don't claim anything. I can be sitting here to say how long I can be having 12 wrong ideas. So I have a daunting responsibility. While you are sitting here only with the intention of reformation, there's nothing you're going to impress anyone by saying, I sat in this man's talk. What do you get out of it? But yes, I have this great responsibility, and may Allah guide me and protect me and all the scholars, that I am the driving seat, because at every moment the devil can come and hijack the goodness of your intention and dilute it with evil. So, O Nabi of Allah, I hand over my chance. Don't divorce me, because there were some issues in the relation as well, and we don't want to go. Don't divorce me. I have excused you, and you can. فَكَانَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ يَقْسِمُ لِعَيْشَةَ يَوْمَيْنِ. And I've seen this in my own relation and my siblings. A parent loves them, all the kids more. But some child has won the confidence of his father even more, or has won the confidence of his mom. Now, instead of arguing with that sibling of yours and creating malice in your heart, salute that brother of yours. Boy, I salute you. I honor you. And that's what the brothers of Yusuf said. قَالُوا تَاللَّهِ لَقَدْ آثَرَكَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْنَا
قالوا تالله لقد آثرك الله علينا وإن كنا لخاطئين.
Listen, Yusuf, we hated you with a passion. We wanted to drop you. We wanted to end your life. We drop our heads in submission. Our hat off for you. We salute you. You're a great man. We say it openly, without any form of reservation. Our dad loves you more, and you love him more, and rightfully so. We now want to win his confidence by acknowledging your relation. But when you get petty and you start bickering, then you lose your relation with your sibling and your parent. To say, no, I always say to youngsters, as long as you are judging your parents, you're a child. You are immature. If you're holding that grudge, my dad gave him more and gave me less, oh my friend, I'm afraid, you are light years behind. You better get up quickly and sort your act out and stop holding anything in your heart for your parents. فكان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يقسم لعائشة يومين يومها ويوم سودة. So the Nabi of Allah would give Aisha radiallahu anha two nights. One was her own right and one was the right of her co-wife that had gifted it, and that was Sauda radiallahu anha. In doing so, Sauda only came so much closer to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And what did she say? فإني أريد أن أبعث مع نسائك يوم القيامة. Oh Nabi of Allah, I don't need to have time in this world. I just want to be part of those women who stand up on your side as your wives on the day of Qiyamah. That's all. Everything, if we are not worried who takes the credit, who stole the show, who took the platform. No. We need to get the wheel turning. And I leave you with the last incident. And this is on the flip side of it. That was the positive and that's the negative. There was this man, Qarun. We heard of him, we read about him, we know about him. The Quran speaks about him. But briefly, let me run you through a few things. And this is serious, and that is why I conclude on this note. The narration of Ibn Kathir, and this is where I read it. Ibn Jurayj says, كَانَ أَكْثَرُ أَهْلِ الْعِلْمِ عَلَىٰ أَنَّهُ إِبْنُ عَمِّ مُوسَىٰ. The majority of scholars say that Qarun was the cousin of Musa alayhi salam. Listen very attentively. We're not talking of an ordinary man. The cousin of Musa alayhi salam. The narration of Qatada in Ibn Kathir, and I read it myself, كَانَ يُسَمَّ مُنَوَّرْ. He was known as the enlightened individual because he had this melodious voice with which he would recite the Torah. The narration of Ruhul Ma'ani on the strength of Muhammad ibn Ishaq, كَانَ حَافِظًا لِلْتَوْرَاتِ. He just didn't recite the Torah, he had imbibed the Torah. He had memorized the Torah. The narration of Ma'riful Qur'an, and in Ruh al-Ma'ani this is also mentioned, that when Sayyidina Musa had selected 70 individuals and he went to Mount Tur, and those 70 individuals were privileged to converse with Allah. وَاخْتَارَ مُوسَى قَوْمَهُ 70 رَجُلًا لِمِيقَاتِنَا وَاخْتَارَ مُوسَى قَوْمَهُ 70 رَجُلًا لِمِيقَاتِنَا. Imagine this great privilege that 70 ordinary mortals were given the opportunity to converse with Allah. And amongst that 70 was Qarun. That's the accolades. And the narration of Ma'riful Qur'an, he came to Musa alayhi salam. He said, I'm your cousin. Your brother Harun is my cousin. You two are prophets and I'm not a prophet. You know the Torah, I know the Torah. So what distinguishes you from me? What gives you this edge above me? What gives you this superiority over me? Common family, you've mastered the Torah. I have a beautiful voice. I have all what it takes to qualify for a prophet. Why not me? Why not me? So Musa alayhi salam said, hang on, I didn't put in an application form. You know what? Applying for prophethood, pending. Keep on checking your emails for updates. We'll keep you posted. You'll hear a beep. We'll drop you a mail. No, nothing like that. This was the choice of Allah, and Allah decided this, and really I cannot say otherwise. But obviously he couldn't reconcile to see somebody else going ahead. Remember in my early statements I said what Imam Ghazali said, that فَإِنَّ الدُّنْيَا لَا تَخْلُو قَطُّ عَنْ خَلْقٍ كَثِيرٍ مِّنْ أَقْرَانِهِ وَمَعَارِفِهِ مِمَّنْ أَنْعَمَ اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِمْ بِعِلْمٍ أَوْ مَالٍ أَوْ جَاهٍ أَوْ مَحَبَّةٍ فِي قُلُوبِ النَّاسِ. The system of Allah is there will always be someone in your school, in your institution, in your fraternity, amongst your peers, that will be one above. And that is the choice of Allah. That is the decree of Allah. So you're up against the system of Allah. You're up against the system of Allah. Musa alayhi salam said, this is the choice of Allah and I cannot say anything. Anyway, this was brewing within him. So now he started plotting and conniving. And let me draw you, I know time is running to a very sensitive point. In the concluding verses of Surah Nas, where Allah wraps up the Quran, Allah says, وَمِن شَرِّ حَاسِدٍ إِذَا حَسَدٍ. Allah didn't ask or instruct us to ask protection from the jealous. Allah didn't say ask protection from the jealous. Allah said, seek protection from the jealous when he cannot contain his jealousy. Seek protection from the jealous when he starts displaying his jealousy. And the scholars of tafsir, they dissect this, jazahumullahu anna khair al-jaza, because a certain degree of envy grips the heart of every human with no exception. So when I see my peer going ahead, there is a twinge that gets into me and says, oh, well, I wish I had it. As long as I don't speak nasty, I don't make derogatory remarks, I don't try physically to put him down, I don't mobilize an anti-campaign, then that is hopefully outside the forbidden. But it's human within me when I see someone go ahead or excels me to feel something within me. Hence we say, Allah save us from the jealous when they become envious and they cannot contain their emotions and they throw it out. So anyway, one day Sayyidina Musa, and this is mentioned in Tafsir al-Samarqandi, Bahrul Ulum, and that's exactly where I read it. Sayyidina Musa alayhi salatu wasalam gathered Qarun and he said to him, إِنَّ اللَّهَ أَمَرَنِي أَنْ أَخُذَ مِنْ مَالِكَ الزَّكَاةِ. Allah has told me to collect zakat from your wealth. فَأَعْطِنِي مِنْ كُلِّ مِئَتَي دِرْهَمْ خَمْسَ دَرَاهِمْ. So from 200, give me 5 dirhams. He said, no, not at all. That's too much. You're claiming a lot. So Musa alayhi salam reduced it and he said, okay, from 1,000, give me 1 dirham. So he said, no, I won't give you a dime. I won't give you anything. إِنَّ مُوسَى لَمْ يَرْضَى حَتَّى تَنَاوَلَ أَمْوَالَكُمْ. Musa wants to usurp your wealth and he wants to consume your assets. So he gathered his people and he said, we need to do something to this man. I beg for your undivided attention. So they said, رَأْيُنَا لِرَأْيُكَ تَبْعُنْ. You make the call, we'll comply. They said, okay, let's institute a claim of adultery against him. Now this is it. A jealous man loses his sanity. He loses his brains. Just remember who we're talking of? The cousin of Moses. Who we're talking of? A man who conversed with Allah. Who we're talking of? A man who memorized the Torah. And you need to know in sequence after the Quran, the next kitab is the Torah. وَلَقَدْ آتَيْنَا مُوسَى وَهَارُونَ الْفُرْقَانِ وَلَقَدْ آتَيْنَا مُوسَى وَهَارُونَ الْفُرْقَانَ وَضِيَاءً وَذِكْرًا لِلْمُتَّقِينَ. Allah has praised the Torah. A man who spoke to Allah. So anyway, Musa alayhi salam makes a public address. They speak to some woman, pay her a handsome amount, and then she comes forward. They say, oh Musa, what's the penalty of a person who's guilty of theft? Musa alayhi salam said, this is the consequences. وَإِنْ سَرَقْتَ أَنْتَ. But what happens if you're guilty of theft? He said, surely the same will apply to me. Nobody is above the law. Okay. وَإِنْ zina, and if somebody commits zina, adultery, fornication, infidelity, promiscuity, they said, these are the consequences. وَإِنْ zanaita أَنْتَ. And what about you, oh Musa, if you've done it? Oh, the consequences are same to me and to everyone. He said, well Musa, don't speak so bold because na'udhu billah, it gives me a shiver in my body to even quote those words. Oh Musa, wal'iyadhu billah, wal'iyadhu billah, you have committed and perpetrated adultery. Musa said, what? No, this is now blatant, this is really nasty, this is completely bizarre and ludicrous. They called that woman up. And he said, that woman will speak. It's in Bahrul Ulum, as I mentioned, this entire narration. This woman, you've committed zina with her. Musa alayhi salam looked at her and he said, أَسْأَلُكِ بِالَّذِي فَلَقَ الْبَحْرَ وَضَلَّلَ الْغَمَامَ. I ask you in the name of Allah who split the waters for Bani Israel. And ask you in the name of Allah who sent the clouds to shade them in the desert. Speak the truth and fear Allah. She said, إِذَا كُنْتَ حَلَفْتَنِي فَأَشْهَدُ أَنَّكَ بَرِيءٌ. Now that you've taken Allah's name, I exonerate you totally. You are sinless and you are free. It is Qarun who had set this entire thing up so that I can implicate you
purely because of his jealousy against you. The moment was overbearing. The moment was too colossal. Sayyidina Musa fell into sajda. Kharra Musa sajida. He fell into prostration. Allah said, Ma yubkika ya Musa. Read the narration in Bahrul Ulum. Musa, what makes you tear and sob? He said, Oh my Lord, I think you've given too much grace and clemency and respite to this man. He's now taken his agenda against me to the accusation of infidelity and adultery, O Allah. Allah said, Oh Musa, do not be afraid. قَدْ أَمَرْتُ الْأَرْضَ أَن تُطِيعَكَ The land is at your command. Gesture it and it will surrender to you. At that moment, Sayyidina Musa said, Oh my Allah, no mercy to this man. Let the earth split and let him go down. And the Quran says, فَخَسَفْنَا بِهِ وَبِدَارِهِ الْأَرْضِ فَخَسَفْنَا بِهِ وَبِدَارِهِ الْأَرْضِ فَمَا كَانَ لَهُ مِنْ فِئَةٍ يَنْصُرُونَهُ مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ وَمَا كَانَ مِنَ الْمُنْتَصِرِينَ وَأَصْبَحَ الَّذِينَ تَمَنَّوْا مَكَانَهُ بِالْأَمْسِ يَقُولُونَ وَيْكَأَنَّ اللَّهَ يَبْسُطُ الرِّزْقَ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ يَبْسُطُ الرِّزْقَ لِمَنْ يَشَاءُ مِنْ عِبَادِهِ وَيَقْدِرُ لَوْلَا أَمَّنَّ اللَّهُ عَلَيْنَا لَخَسَفَ بِنَا وَيْكَأَنَّهُ لَا يُفْلِحُ الْكَافِرُونَ Your hearts would burst. The Quran said, all those that envied him in his glory days, when the man was running, when the man was performing, when the man was in office, and when they seen the catastrophic repercussions and consequences, they said, Allah, rather we don't have what he had and meet with a fate like this, Allah. Better I was never in the driving seat, never had this opportunity, nor possessed this greed, and that were his ending. We ask Allah to protect us. We ask Allah to rid our hearts. I swear by Allah, my brother, I say this in the house of Allah, I said absolutely nothing, and I swear this in the house of Allah, hinting to any person, I don't ever use the sanctity of this podium to ever lash out at any person in any of my talks. I will be violating the sanctity of this podium if I have vested interest when I stand up here. I stand up in the humble capacity of a scholar and I pray and I hope that Allah will translate my sentiments in some meaningful change, not here or around this place, but across the globe. And I leave you with the last words of Abu Darda radiallahu anhu. He said, "Man akthara dhikr al-maut, qalla farhuhu wa qalla hasaduhu." If you want to remedy your heart and you want to change your heart, he said, the one who thinks of death often, that I have to meet my Allah, he will laugh less and he will have no time to harbor jealousy. What did Sayyidina Abu Darda say? The one who thinks of death often, he will laugh less and he will have absolutely no time to waste in bickering. I pray and I hope and I ask the Almighty to effect this change in my life and in the brothers and the sisters that have gathered here. And may Allah rescue the Ummah. May Allah restore the honor of this Ummah. May Allah restore the glory of this Ummah. May Allah give us the spirit of brotherhood, that just as we sympathize in the pain of others, we participate in the achievements of the Ummah. Wa akhiru da'wana anil hamdulillahi rabbil alamin.